It's an honor to be here with you all this beautiful afternoon, but also with so many of my heroes, teachers, mentors, and friends. So I want to say hi to all of you, especially the OGs in the house. OGs. These are, it's another term for our elders, our teachers, our wise counselors. So I want to spend my time talking a little bit about power. And I want to talk about power as it relates to electoral organizing and strategies, because Max, I think your many salient points, of the many salient points that you made, we are in a moment where we have a lot more conversation to have interrogating the usefulness of electoral strategies and electoral organizing in this moment, not just on its face as kind of a neutral terrain, but as a terrain by which the left can or should build power. And I think this is still very much a debate happening today. But I want to start off my comments really by just sharing a little bit about how I get to be here standing with you, which is that after 2016 and Donald Trump was declared the winner of the contest between himself and Hillary Clinton, about almost a year later, Max asked me to pen the foreword to Revolution in the Air because it was being re-released. Now, this is my copy that I bought in 2003, when I was an intern at the School of Unity and Liberation. And I will tell you, and I told you this in the new foreword, that I read maybe this much. And I said, oh my gosh, this is really interesting. I'll come back to it. And so nearly 15 years later, being asked to pen the foreword for the book really enticed me, of course, to get past that first ace and really go deeper. And I was so grateful to be asked because I was in a different position to be able to understand some of the stories and some of the lessons that were being highlighted here. And in my remarks, I say that I often wonder what would have happened if I had read this book earlier. But hey, hindsight is 20/20. And I gotta say that where I find solace is that these are questions that we're going to be grappling with for a long time. And so my push to each of us is not so much to be trying to run to the finish line, but instead to be able to put ourselves in a position where we can make new mistakes. Okay? So the next version of Revolution in the Air that comes out should have a litany of lessons that we've learned and new challenges that we are trying to take on. And what I can tell you about Max and Gerald and Uncle Phil and Huli is that they have been saying that to me for a very long time. Time to make new mistakes, youngster. They're right. So first and foremost, I want to start off just by reading a little bit of what I shared in the foreword that I wrote. And it starts off here. The election of Donald Trump on November 9th, 2016 was a bittersweet reminder of a series of dynamics and their consequences. During the election, the left missed several important opportunities. One was an opportunity to extend the conversation curated by movements like Occupy Wall Street to highlight the dangers of capitalism. Another was the opportunity offered by candidates like Bernie Sanders to further expand the conversation about socialism. And yet another was to resist the narrowing of our vision into issues as opposed to a larger program for freedom and democracy for all. Still another was the opportunity to resist co-opting the language of liberals who bemoaned identity politics as a way to destabilize important demands made in the service of dismantling structural inequality and racism. The radical left adopted characteristics of three basic positions with respect to the most recent election. One position was that the election represented a contest between two sides of the same coin, that there was no fundamental difference between the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, and thus engaging the election would demonstrate an adherence to the corrupt two-party system, thereby constituting an act of treason against left principles, politics, and values. Another position was that Hillary Clinton was simply too corrupt to vote for. As such, they would sit out the election, or else they would vote for a third party, such as the Green Party or the Libertarian Party. And still another position was somewhere in between, that the primary task was to defeat Donald Trump and the GOP's hateful agenda, or that Hillary Clinton, while not perfect, represented the best of what was possible under neoliberalism, and that a vote for her was a vote in favor of women's equality. My estimation, from my position in things, was that most of the left was somewhere in between the first two positions, that both parties and or candidates were irreparably corrupt, and therefore it was a betrayal to the left to engage in any other manner besides critique. Now, I offer this not as like a finger wagging, but as somebody who is inside of a very tumultuous terrain, inside of a very tumultuous terrain. And by saying that, what I mean is that as the co-founder of the Black Lives Matter Global Network, which is an organization that has 40 chapters in 4 countries, nobody knew better than I the challenge of trying to unite many visions, many values, into a coherent strategy that could accomplish a short-term victory towards a longer-term vision. And what we found, quite frankly, was that a lot of our members, a lot of the people who are engaged with us, felt very strongly that electoral organizing and the electoral system was not a terrain on which we should battle. And that, in fact, to battle on that terrain meant a fundamental betrayal to the values that they felt they espoused. Okay? And there was no separating of those two things. My values and time, place, and conditions, what's moving right now. And as a result, I think that we missed several important opportunities. I can say, however, that we went into that period having shaped culture, and having shaped a series of conversations about what it meant to support Black lives. We were able to shape every Democratic and Republican's narrative around Black people and Black liberation, and in particular, around police violence. That is something that I think many of us could not see through the fog of what was happening around us. That we had already made inroads into being able to shift how people were approaching our movement. And therefore, we were in a position to make a certain set of demands that I think we did not make. I can say that one of the fundamental challenges that we still face as a movement has to do with understanding power and how it must be transformed. Power in a lot of arenas is talked about as our personal power, aka empowerment. I feel powerful. My values make me feel powerful. And that is important, right? Everybody likes to wake up in the morning and be like, ugh, in this thing, right? However, your personal empowerment isn't changing how decisions are being made, which is one way that I understand power. Our personal empowerment isn't changing the ways in which resources are distributed, generated, and consumed. Another way to understand power. Our personal empowerment has not proven successful in being able to reward people in power for doing the right thing and to levy consequences when they do the wrong thing. That is another way that I understand power. And in some ways, our personal empowerment could go further to shape how we understand what's right and what's wrong, and who is the we. One of the things that we became very clear about during 2016 was that there were several fractures, one of which was along the lines of culture. Understanding who are we? What does it mean to be America? When the leading candidate, Donald Trump, said, "We want to make America great again," that had a lot of salience for a lot of people. And the reason was not because he's brilliant, obvi. The reason was that there's a general discontent that's happening right now around how we act, who we are, and who we can be. And as of yet, there has not been a force that could emerge that can clarify what's possible for who we can be together. There has not yet been a force to emerge that has clarified and shaped the narrative of who we are currently. Okay? So that is still a ground that is being contested. And the way that we know that, of course, is from the autopsy of the 2016 election. Now, after many of us pried ourselves out of tightly wound balls, it took me about 2 months. I was sad. Devastated, really. After many of us pried ourselves out of the tightly wound balls that we had wrapped ourselves up in, many of us tried to understand what happened. And I can tell you that from my perspective, what happened was that 30 years of really smart, strategic organizing that was able to cast a wide net and give people language for who we are and who we can be, took power in this country in a way that we haven't seen. And when I say take power, I don't mean that they woke up, said, "Hey, we won the election," and felt personally empowered. What I mean is that 30 years of building institutions, 30 years of building base in every possible sector you can imagine, was consolidated, and consolidated on the extreme side of what we know as the right wing in this country. So what that means tangibly is that the extreme side of the right now controls the presidency, the White House, Congress, 2/3 of state legislatures. Yeah, 2/3. And also soon to be the Supreme Court. And as we know, each one of those bodies is making decisions over our futures and over our present. And so you can see that feeling personally empowered and feeling right and morally right does very little to shift that balance of power. Now, with that being said, the autopsy, okay, from our side was, there were many, Bernie would have won. Hillary Clinton was robbed. Or, from the less left side of the left, with a little L, we spent way too much time on identity politics. We spent way too much time talking about small groups of people, as opposed to talking about the things that connect us all, like class. And in fact, what we must do moving towards 2020 is solely focused on class, and a small segment of class, meaning the white working class, mostly living in rural areas. because that is the strategy that's taking back the White House. Now, many of you know that is not a new strategy, and it also has not been a successful one on this side of things. But many of you also should understand that many of us adopted that language. Language of conservatives who already decry raising and making more visible racial segregation and inequality, okay, who have built multi-year strategies to suppress how we understand racial inequality and segregation. So much so that we are now uncomfortable even mentioning race, aka all lives matter. And so, Max's book, Revolution in the Air, tends toward helping us understand better how to make new mistakes. Those things that I just mentioned, those are mistakes that we make over and over and over again. And luckily for us, in 2018 and in 2020, we have an opportunity right now to make different mistakes. Isaac, you asked, and we'll probably talk more about this, if it's appropriate for us to understand history as a series of spiraling collection of moments that open opportunities for new moments, otherwise known as dialectics. And I would say yes. I would say yes. But to keep moving up the spiral and the town, we've got to be courageous enough to evaluate how effective being right has been. I think that our task in this moment is not to be right, but to build power. Power, not the individualized, I feel powerful because I feel right kind of power, but the power that captures the hearts and minds of millions. Our task in this moment is to build a movement in the millions, not the hundreds, not the dozens, not the thousands, not even the 10,000s, the millions. And so in order to do that, it doesn't mean that we have to abandon what we hold to be most dear. It doesn't mean that we have to abandon our vision for what's possible. It means that we have to figure out a different way to build synergy and synthesis between politics as they are and politics as they should be. And that is a very delicate dance. And many who have tried it from our side of things have ended up wayward. Let's be honest. Because in some ways, right, one of the great contributions, I think, of the period of 1968 before and after is organizations that allow us to be in a position to not just fuddle through the mundane and try to work inside of politics as it is with no vision for how it can be. The role of organizations, in many ways, is to spark our political and revolutionary imagination. But the other piece of our imagination that must be sparked is how do we get from where we are to where we hope to be. And so what I want to do in my last few minutes, because I want us to actually talk more and me talk less at you and with you instead, what I want to share is some work that we're doing now to try and address the gap between where we are and where we think we need to go. So as I said, after I pried myself out of a tightly wound ball, in November of 2016, I went back to notebooks and cell phone notes and other rants that I had stashed in different places that actually helped me get through what was a very muddy, unclear period. And by muddy and unclear, what I mean is, again, how do we move through this landscape of Democrat and Republican who are not actually saying the same things, but neither of them are saying the things that need to be said, much less moving a program that needs to be moved? And I was working inside of a network of organizations and people who all work towards making Black Lives Matter. But we do that in different ways, with different approaches, and with different understandings of what it means on the other side. For some of us, right, we decry and abhor electoral organizing. For others of us, we see it as a series of tools that can get us closer to where we want to go. And still for others, right, we are deeply distrustful of any systems of power as they exist right now. You can imagine that was a hard place to be. When there was a choice to be made that was not a popular choice on either end. So for me, how I got through that period was by freedom dreaming. And thinking about if we had the kind of organization that could have a miner's light that cut through the dark, what would that look like? And it was from there that the Black Futures Lab was born. Oh, thanks for the snaps. I have like three snaps. And I'm into three snaps. Because the Black Futures Lab is really focused on building independent, progressive, Black political power. 2016 was hard for Black folks. We had candidates going on talk shows, doing the Dougie. But when pressed about how they would make Black Lives Matter, either lectured organizers and protesters about the clarity of their demands, although it's pretty clear how we can do to make Black Lives Matter, two, denied that there was any kind of difference between Black folks and other folks, right? So why are we even talking about that kind of a thing? Or three, use Black people as symbols as opposed to working with Black people with substance. So we saw, for example, many, many members of the Mothers of the Movement who are mothers who have lost their children to police and state violence align themselves with a candidate that they felt could potentially make more visible the changes that they wanted to see in a broken criminal justice system. And many felt like that was their only choice. But how do we move from Black people being purely symbolic, allegiance to a progressive agenda that is rarely specific about how to make Black Lives Matter? How do we move from that to Black people living powerfully? And by living powerfully, I mean making decisions over our own lives. I mean shaping culture and shaping narrative. I mean being able to reward and punish. And I mean having a clear vision of who we are and who we can be. And so the Black Futures Lab aims to transform Black communities into constituencies that build power in cities and states. Our first project has been an initiative called the Black Census Project. And in that initiative, we are talking to 200,000 Black people across the country about how we act politically and what we want for our futures. So that instead of being told Black people don't vote, Black people don't care, Black people aren't engaged, from our own mouths, we can talk about how we're involved, why we do or decide not to vote, how we're engaged in governance locally and at the state level, but most importantly, from our own mouths, what do we want to see for our futures? The Black Census Project understands that black people are not a monolith, that demographics inside of black communities have changed, but our strategies have not caught up to the ways in which black communities are shifting. And so that means moving 100 black organizers in 20 states this year to really get to communities that are often left out of conversations about black people, by black people who are migrants, black people living in rural areas, black people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, gender nonconforming, black people who are incarcerated and formerly incarcerated, and black people who don't see themselves right now as a part of our movement. Let me say that again. Black people who do not see themselves currently as a part of our movement. So that means from 200,000 black people, we expect that there will be many places where black folks align with what we know as a progressive agenda, and there will be many places where we diverge. And those places where we diverge are not places for us to throw people away, but instead to embrace and see it as a deeper opportunity for more strategic organizing. We've built a database to allow for everyone who participates in the census by collecting responses to have access to that data, not just for where they collected it, but for national. And we've also decided that we will use this data as the basis of a Black Public Policy Institute that we're calling Black to the Future. It's good, right? It's good, right? And Black to the Future will train grassroots leaders in Black communities how to legislate solutions. Not because policy is the answer to everything, but because, as you said, Max, it is important to take the middle people out of the experience of people and the government so that we can more broadly expose how deeply flawed our democracy actually is. And once we get there, it's not the time to get into smaller and smaller groups that agree that democracy is fundamentally flawed. Instead, the Black to the Future Project works to reimagine how democracy can function. So, those are just a couple of things that we're up to. That is not a Black Lives Matter project, but Black Lives Matter is still important in this ecosystem. Why? Because the saliency of Black Lives Matter allows for a wide range of black people to come together, identify the root causes of problems that we face in our communities, in our lives, and strategize together about how we get from where we are to where we want to be. In that process, there will be many debates, many disagreements, and that's important because we have not designated a set of tactics that network must take on. At the Black Futures Lab, however, our goal is to build capacity for a growing movement that is hungry for figuring out how is it that we actually make Black Lives Matter? And how do we engage all the tools that we have available to us to get closer to where we want to be? Now, we know that reform is not the only answer, but we believe that we can play with what it means for our communities to be engaged in a different way that can impact institutions that right now make decisions over our lives. This is, of course, inside of a moment where parties, Democrat, Republican, Independents, Libertarians, have less saliency. What does it mean today to be a Democrat, a Republican, an Independent, or a Libertarian? They are shades of gray at this point. That could change, or we could fill the space with something different. we have an opportunity, I think, to start to build the alternatives that we want to see without completely disengaging from things as they are. Let me close with this. A reinvigorated left, as I say in the foreword, will have a clear vision for the world we strive to win and a deep connection and resonance with wide swaths of people who share an interest in their personal and our collective liberation. This new and vibrant left will be grounded in theories derived from experiments that we have embarked on, tangible contributions we have made to our communities and to people's lives. And it will actively work to nurture all of the diverse components necessary for a successful movement. The left we deserve will be sharp in our assessment of the dialectical relationship between social systems and economic systems. It will understand and engage directly with power. It will be rooted in a set of strategies aimed at taking power and transforming it from power over to power with. It will be diverse in its tactics, and it will be guided by winning tangible improvements in people's lives and evaluated by the millions of people that it attracts and retains. I believe, still, even in the age of Donald Trump, that a revolution is absolutely necessary and absolutely possible. And I look forward to building that revolution with you. Thank you.